And what is happening, people? Bishar Ketu here, Amazon FBA seller from beautiful San Diego. In today's episode, I have a very special guest all the way from the UK, who's originally actually from Italy, which is pretty awesome. My man, Emmanuel Vinci, who is an eight-figure Amazon seller, speaker, author, and digital course author who helps people start their own businesses from home through dropshipping, FBA at wholesale level, and turning their dropship products into FBA and distribution in Europe. And also, he helps them utilize their cash flow to build their own private label business. So what's happening, brother? How are you today?
I'm fantastic. Thanks for having me, Bashar. It's an honor to be here with you and your audience. Hi, everyone.
Well, that's awesome, man. That's awesome. I know that there is a bunch of questions. You know, I did actually a post a couple of days ago, and you know, that I was bringing you on, and everyone was wondering, you know, what an eight-figure seller looks like. You know, I'm a seller, you know, seven-figure, but haven't gotten to that eight-figure. So, why don't you tell us a little bit about, you know, who Emmanuel is really? How did you kind of start this whole online thing, and what really brought you in it, and really what was your background, I guess, before getting into it?
Yeah, so I came in the UK from Italy about 17 years ago, and at that point I could not speak English or, you know, even use a PC. Not that I do better talking in English right now, but I'm trying my best, right? So as you can imagine, it's been a long journey before I started the online courses and starting selling online. I've done a lot of jobs until then. Fast forward about 13 years, I started going to we call them car boot sales in the UK, which I think you call it flea market in the US.
That's right.
Where there are a lot of people selling secondhand clothes and things they don't use anymore in their houses. And at that point, I started going in there every Saturday and Sunday morning. I used to wake up at 4 a.m. to just get a bunch of clothes and shoes and all things that people didn't need anymore. And I used to put them on eBay at that point. And I used to buy products for £3-5, put them on eBay and selling them for, you know, a small profit of like £3-10 profit. It used to help me, you know, with the bills, you know, paying the rent. I got this guy one day. He was selling some cool brands such as Armani, Prada, and all this kind of stuff. And I'm like, this guy's crazy selling a Prada skirt for £3. So it goes without saying that I bought everything that he had. And this is the aha moment that made me think this online business works, because I remember selling this Prada skirt for £150 in Finland. I'm like, wow, this is what I want to do. I was so so intrigued, you know, so inspired by this online venture. I thought there is an issue here, though, with the flea markets, you know, the products were not replenishable. So. Right. Just over 4 years ago, I got a mentor that taught me how to drop ship. And I started drop shipping in UK and US. And and that's when my Amazon business really started. And it took off pretty rapidly, because after about 3 months, we were averaging about $60,000 in sales, you know, between the both marketplaces. And I started hiring. So that was what I was missing. I was doing everything by myself, but when I start scaling and hiring employees, I could then replace myself over and over and over again. And rather than be working in the business, I started working on the business and becoming a manager. So rather than be me working part-time, because at that point I still had a full-time job and I used to come back home and source products to sell online like 2, 3, 4 hours a day. It was pretty tiring. At that point, I had three people doing it for me. So rather than be 2 or 3 hours a day, which is like 15 hours a week, I now had three people working 40 hours per week each, 120 hours of labor going into my business. And that's how it really scaled really fast. And After 3 months, I remember like yesterday, I went on Google and I searched for a resignation letter because I thought I need to try and do this full time because, you know, if it's generating $60,000 and I'm doing this part time, just with the help of FBAs at that point, I need to try this full time. I put my resignation in and I started this adventure, let's call it, full time from July 2015. So at first was just all drop shipping, and then being in the UK is a bit different than the US. Because in the US there is not a free market between US, Canada, and Mexico. In Europe, it is like a free market for FBA if you join the Pan-EU FBA. So what happened is all the products that we were drop shipping and selling multiple times a day per week, we thought it's a bit pointless having to place each single order individually when we could. We know now from our own reports, you know, how many units we are selling per month. So it's not a guess game. Guessing how many you're selling with. You can use Jungle Scout. You can use Helium. You can use Async Pro. You can use a lot of software nowadays that will estimate how many sales per month you can have on a product based on the bestseller ranking. However, what they don't tell you is how many units you can sell if there are 10 sellers on a product, right? Because as you know, the buy box varies between sellers. If there is a seller with 10,000 reviews versus a new launch seller, the one with 10,000 reviews, and if it's got good metrics, will get a higher percentage of the buy box. So with dropshipping, you got that chance to really see what is your monthly sales, you know, not just a guess. Right. So we could look at our, see that we are selling 30, 50, 100 of a product. So at that point, what we did was start contacting wholesalers and manufacturers. So we weren't drop shipping anymore from retailers. We were actually reducing costs and increasing margins by contacting wholesalers for those products, getting authorization from those brands to resell already well-known brands, right? Okay. And that allowed us to do FBA, not just in the UK, but we joined in the Pan-EU FBA, which then gave us the opportunity to expand our business in 28 countries in Europe. Wow. That's how, you know, I managed to get to 8 figures in 4 years, because we basically used the dropshipping model as a tester to get the FBA going. And then I started to really get into private label, because that's actually how I started 4 years ago. I don't know if you ever read of dropshipping domination. Uh-huh. It was an old school coaching program that I joined. And when I was going at the flea markets, there was this guy that used to sell me gym towels. And these gym towels were selling for £1, one sterling. I was getting 4 gym towels, which was selling each at £3.50. And it was a great return on investment. Wow. So one day this guy said, you know, I've not got any more towels. And I was absolutely devastated. I'm like, this is one of the pros that is giving me the best return on investment. Right. So I've got to create my own. So, that was actually my very first product on Amazon, which was generating like from 10 to 15,000 pounds in profit a year. So after I'd done all this drop shipping business and the FBA in Europe, I then thought I want to get back into how I actually started, which was that private label. And that's how I started now creating a brand and creating my own product, which with the idea to then start to contact big boys, as Walmart, Bed Bath & Beyond, you know, Home Depot, and open my brand. Or I could actually get it into an investor. And if I get over the million in the next 12 months, I can then probably get a big book for it, like $5 to $10 million on the brand itself. But I'll see which one is best at that point.
That's awesome, man. Well, that's an amazing story, you know, and it's kind of literally every single entrepreneur that I brought here that actually has done Amazon, it's always started like either arbitrage or online arbitrage, drop shipping or something. Like when I first started, I know I used to go to Home Goods, Walmart, Target, and then me and my wife would buy like toys and drop ship them on Amazon. So it's, I guess it's just an easier point of entry, you know, because you don't have to come up with a whole bunch of product all at once. You don't have to kind of go there, do product research, things like that, since really a lot of us, especially those that have never done any type of online business, we are used to like going and touching physical products in our hand, you know, rather than just kind of seeing with our eyes. But then once you get the taste of like how, you know, passive private label is, where you're just, everything is done online, you're not touching anything, you're not storing anything, you're not shipping anything, really the shift is just, you know, mind blowing. So that's an awesome story. Now tell us a little bit about, I know that you said that you sell on Amazon UK and also Amazon US. What do you think is the biggest difference between the two markets today?
Certainly the competition market. Yep. The US marketplace, it's harder to find, well, it's not harder. The competition now is getting higher in the UK as well. So first of all, I actually sell everywhere now. I sell in the US, UK, Germany, France, Italy, Spain, Australia, and Japan. It's harder in the sense of getting ranked straight away on page one. It's much easier to do that in the UK, in Japan, and Australia, where the competition is much lower. However, I still managed to put products on page one on Amazon US. It's all about the techniques that you use, how you start the whole process, how good your listings are, the softwares that you use. So I do like a reverse search engine of the main keywords utilized by the top competitors that are already on page one to make sure that I'm using the right keywords to rank, to make sure that you get reviews right away and you do a good product launch. So yeah, there are different steps that can help you to get on page one on Amazon US as well. But yeah, going back to your question, I believe the US is still the hardest one because all major sellers are in the US. Right. So yeah, I find it easier to sell, probably because I'm in here as well. Also creating relationships, there are a little bit more challenges for me being in the UK to open manufacturers' accounts in the US, for example, because of some documentation that they asked me for, which I can provide for what is the UK, but there might be a little bit more fussy in the US, you know?
Absolutely, man. You're definitely right. Now, do you think the demand is less? So let's say the competition is definitely less in these marketplaces, but what about the demand, though?
The demand is still high in here as well now. Okay. Amazon is right now, it's growing up. Like from 2017 to 2018 was the biggest growth of Amazon, over 60 billions. It grew. So I don't think, and I can't see Amazon slowing down anytime soon. This is the best time to start selling on Amazon. So demand is higher than ever in the UK as well. My sales, last night we were at 98% on sales and 204% above average sale per item above last year. Wow. So that showed me that the market is growing, and another marketplace, also the German one. And it's a great opportunity as well, especially if you're in the private label world, to start selling in Australia and Japan, because Japan has got great demand. But the product that I put in there on private label went on page one, right, the first day. So it stayed there. And for example, there are over 27,000 sellers of that product in the UK, and it was like a bunch of a few hundreds only. So that's how easy it is in there. Only right. In Japan, you have to have someone that acts as your importer. Otherwise, you won't be able to sell FBA there. You cannot send it directly from, let's say, your Chinese manufacturer directly to Amazon. They will not accept it. So you need to have somebody that acts as an importer. But I've got all that figured after, you know, trials and error. I've done a lot of mistakes as well along the way, so it's not been easy to get to that 1 million mark, but you know, between good things and bad things, we got there at the end.
Absolutely.
I've only achieved it 2 months ago, so I'm a fresh eight figure seller.
That's awesome, man. That is awesome. So why don't you kind of take us through the process of, so let's say if someone lives in the US or outside of the US and they're trying to sell in Amazon UK, what are the main, thing of entry to start selling on UK? What are some of the most important things that they need to worry about before starting selling on the UK?
So for what I can see from my students, so most of my students are actually from the US, because I also sell in the US, and I managed to get people that wanted to start their own business right there. And everyone has the same kind of fear, which is the VAT. Oh, what is this VAT?
Right.
So VAT is certainly something that you've got to apply if you don't live in the UK right away, right off the bat. You need to have a VAT certificate, which you can easily apply online for. But yeah, that seems to be the biggest fear from US residents to sell in the UK. But my advice is just do it, you know, because, for example, I sold in the US right away, and there's been challenges, especially with payments to suppliers that didn't accept UK cards. There are way arounds and solutions for everything. So just do it, and you will open your products, not just to 300 million people that are in the US, but now you've got an extra 70 million, I think, in the UK. And if you start doing that FBA with the Pan-EU, that's 700 million people. So now your products are visible to a billion people rather than just focusing in the US only. And it's good to have multiple sources of income, right?
Absolutely. And then would you suggest that someone, if someone has a successful product selling on Amazon US, would you suggest them selling the same exact product in other marketplaces or looking for other products that are in demand in those other marketplaces?
A little bit of both, a little bit of both. But my theory is that what goes in one place, we are all humans, no matter what language we speak or where we are from. Right, there are replenishable products. Like, I'm pretty sure that everybody uses toothpaste, everybody uses toilet rolls, everybody uses razors. So things that sell in one marketplace, 9 times out of 10 sells in every marketplace, because when I started with FBA on the products that I was drop shipping already, they were usually from already well-known brands worldwide. But yeah, certainly there are also products that sell more depending on the cultures. So yeah. It's a bit of both, but in 9 times out of 10, you know, the most replenishable products are in demand in all marketplaces. And, you know, to see that, I don't know if you use Keepa, which is an excellent software that tells you what those products are selling in all marketplaces. And right away, you can see if that product is on the other marketplaces and what is the price point. For example, there are electronics in the UK that sells much cheaper here than what they sell in Europe. So there right away, there is a bigger opportunity to create margins.
Absolutely, man. Absolutely. That's an awesome advice. I know your time is really tight, and then we got to let you go in a little bit. I got two more questions for you. Number one
of course,
is
go ahead.
Number one is, what is the best tool you think out there today that will help Amazon sellers the most, that it's like a must, like you have to have in order for you to be successful selling on Amazon?
Well, when I open my Amazon.com, it's full of softwares, but it depends for what you want to do. So for drop shipping, you know, it's easy to find a lot of products with OAX Ray, right? And we use DS Amazon Quick View, which is a free Chrome extension that you can use, tells you straight away which ones are the seller ranking and how many sellers there are. I actually got the extended version where we can eliminate FBA and Amazon as a seller, so that helps us to just compete with FBM, which is easier to rank for on dropshipping. But what is about FBA? The FBA as private label,
right?
And most have is Helium 10. Helium 10, I believe, is the best out there to help you not only find gold products with high demand and low competition, but also to build a product for what is about the keywords that everybody is using. I mean, the biggest competitors on page ones are using to build a product, the listing, eliminate the keywords that you've already used so that you're not duplicating things. So, yeah, definitely Helium is one of those that you must have, along with Jungle Scout. Jungle Scout is great for research as well.
Absolutely, man, absolutely. And the other question that I have for you is, and you don't have to kind of give up all of your secrets, but what would you think, what is kind of like the best product research criteria? And I guess so let me rephrase. Give us a product research strategy that you use that you are comfortable with discussing with us today.
So the search criteria that I've utilized at the beginning was for drop shipping, it was finding products that were ranking at least 10% below, 10% of a category. So if there are 100,000 in a category and there are websites there that you can check up to see how many products are in a category, stay above that with 10% at the maximum, so that it's not too much of a high ranking that has got very few sales per month. So you want something that has at least, you know, 100 sales per month, and with low competition. The lower the competition, the more of those 100 sales you're gonna get in a month. Right. But what is about FBA, because you are investing on something forward, so you are gonna be buying in bulk. At that point, you should be really sticking under 1% of that category, so the sales velocity is higher, although the competition is higher in there as well. But right, there are ways to always find products with lower competition for what is about the numbers of sellers that are selling a product. There are softwares out there, such as Jungle Scout, that can tell you how many people are selling a product, and you can sort it by revenue generated with how many sales per month. You just do a quick, you divide that number of sales per month by the numbers of sellers, and you can get an estimate or idea of how many units you can expect to sell per month. You can actually use Jungle Scout slash estimator to give you an estimate of how many units that product sells per month. Divide that by the number of sellers, and you get an idea of how many times you can expect to sell that product. Then you can use, again, another free tool, FBA fee calculator. Put there the ASIN number, put there the price the product is sold for, put there the cost that you can expect to get it from your wholesaler or manufacturer, and you can get an estimate profit based on the expected numbers of sales. And then for the private label is a complete different thing, because it depends on how good you are at creating a product that has got high demand and low competition, and how good is your listing. So make sure you've got all the pictures available in there. The pictures need to have pictures, they need to have live examples of it, and needs to really look great, so that when people are scrolling through Amazon on their phone, for example, your listing has got to stand out. You need to catch their attention. And these are pretty much the biggest tips I can give out.
Absolutely, man. Absolutely. So one last thing before you go, what do you have? What is the one thing that you say, or you have to say to, you know, beginner sellers or someone trying to sell on Amazon in 2019? What is really the most advice you can give them right now?
Well, it's keep your metrics tight. Don't be afraid, because there is still so much fish in the ocean that a lot of people say, you know, Amazon it might go down. It doesn't, because it's the strongest company out there. I can't see it slowing down at all. If you haven't got capital, you can start with dropshipping. A lot of people say that dropshipping is dead. It's not. Just don't use, make sure that you abide by the dropshipping policy, and make sure that you are authorized by the companies to sell those products, to avoid any infringements, to avoid any issues with Amazon. You want to be... Amazon is all about customer satisfaction, so you must make sure that the focus is your customer. And then as soon as you can, you know, and you're making some money, so you can start with dropshipping with literally no capital. Once you start dropshipping, you can use Ecom Solutions for that, which is a great software to track inventory from your suppliers. I wouldn't advise you to use Walmart, because every dog and his owner uses Walmart through dropship, so avoid using them, because it's Amazon's biggest competitor. And as soon as Amazon comes you dropshipping, they're going to shoot your account down. So avoid that at all costs. And I would also avoid dropship from well-known retailers such as Bed Bath & Beyond and Home Depot. Try to find, there are wholesalers out there that are actually authorized to resell those brands, and they can back you up in case of competitors sending infringements, or the brand owners, you can provide a letter where you're actually authorized to resell those products, and they send you a daily stock quantities with their costs, which you can easily apply to the repricers and Amazon, so that you are always up to date with stock and price. You will not sell out of stocks or things at loss. So yeah. But as soon as you can, I would definitely advise you to expand into FBA and expand worldwide. You know, you need to. I'm one of them. Me, that I throw myself off the plane and then I figure out how to open the parachute. So it's to take some risks in order to make it work. But once it works, it's definitely worth it.
Absolutely, man. Absolutely. Well, my man Emmanuel, I know our time is up here. I really appreciate you coming live with us here on this channel. You know, it's been honestly an honor. It's really always good to see people that are doing, you know, a lot better than all of us. You know what I mean? Because it's, first of all, it's an inspiration, and second of all, it's, as you said, it's a living proof that this works, that this still works, and that the potential is just that large. You know, someone that's done that many digits and that's been around in the game for that long. It just, you know, gives us an insight on, okay, look, yeah, you maybe started as a four figure, went to five, then six, then seven, and you felt great, but you can still go up more, you know, and those who are trying to start selling on Amazon, like I get this all the time. Oh, well, you know, it's saturated. Well, the money's not there anymore. You know, there are so many sellers. And I always say, yes, there are a lot more sellers than when I first started 3 years ago. But at the same time, there are a lot more buyers. As you said, 2017 and 2018, $60-70 billion in revenue jumped. And really, if you look at Amazon's revenue from like 2006 to 2007 in the past decade or so, Amazon's revenue has been jumping like 10, 15, 20, 30% every single year consistently. It hasn't plateaued. It's just been like this, you know? So
isn't it the best graph ever? If, when you see an Amazon graph, it's probably the best graph ever. It's all up to you.
Absolutely, man. Absolutely. So you, this just should give you an you know, an idea that they're not stopping anytime soon. I mean, I watch Amazon news every day. You know, there's always, they're always, you know, acquiring something new. It's like Amazon is like an octopus. They have their hands in everything now, you know, which is pretty awesome. And it's just, it'll just get better. You know, now will it slow down later in like 5-10 years? Maybe, but you've got 5-10 years to make your money, you know? So definitely, as you said, the time is now. Definitely go in. If any of you guys watching, you know, has a question for me or Emmanuel, drop them in the comment section below. Let us know, you know, you get an insight from an eight-figure seller, which is pretty awesome. Emmanuel, my man, thank you very much for coming on this channel. It's been really an honor. Thank you for your time. And maybe we'll see you here again. And
thank you for having me, Bashar. It's been a pleasure. You can call me anytime.
Absolutely, man. Have yourself a great day, and thank you very much.
Same to you. Thank you. Bye.